First of all, I'd like to thank the Tate University of the Creative Arts and LCC PARC for inviting me. It's a great privilege and also a slightly daunting responsibility to get to speak first at what promises to be a very interesting conference. My title appears simple. The lack of a comma is deliberate. It is not now, comma, and then. Rather, the title indicates the historical fluidity, both of the presence of women as photographers and of the public acknowledgement of our presence. Also, questions of representation, stereotyping, and identity, something that Francis Benjamin Johnson was clearly challenging well over a century ago. I want to identify some ways in which the situation of women in photography has developed over the past three decades, noting shifts in the interrelation of the global and the local. The presence of women in the field, what women photograph, and what we see are, of course, linked. And in terms of fast forward, we might pause to consider how fast and whether we are moving forward. Changes are not necessarily progressive. I was at a Fawcett Society event last month that included a rather depressing discussion of ways in which young women are targeted commercially from an increasingly young age. For example, the online availability of princess outfits that are probably made somewhere in Asia under work conditions that we would not condone. Some photographer somewhere is making these images, and some picture editor is condoning them, so beautifully frozen. As a feminist, I continue to shudder at stereotyping, particularly in fashion and beauty photography and homemaking catalogues. This is not to deny the pleasures of good design. Often it's the pose, not the product. And as we know, images and written texts often reinforce one another. Earlier this week, a Christmas catalogue dropped through my letterbox with the strap line, "Presents for the men and gifts for the girls." The diminutive "girls" addressed to adult women always makes my blood boil. This is 2015. Needless to state, the catalogue went straight into the recycling. My interest in the politics of representation stems from my involvement with the UK women's movement in the 1970s, or from the 1970s onwards. We still need to be involved. As some of you will remember, there were core debates on sex, gender and sexuality, childbirth and the right to choose, and tensions between patriarchal and Marxist models of historical analysis. The era was characterised by campaigns for equal rights. I remember numerous rallies supporting nursery provision, housing and women's aid, sex discrimination, employment rights, equal pays, and gatherings reclaiming the night. The latter still seemed to be needed, especially in university cities. Indeed, given the proposed removal of tax credits for those in work, once again, women will be left holding the baby and making ends meet. The 40th anniversary of the founding of Hackney Flashers was celebrated earlier this year. Plus ça change. Debates were also pursued within academic contexts, not only in terms of the politics of representation, but also ways in which our sense of identity is negotiated through our inscription within ideological discourses, including gender differentiations. What I find particularly interesting in this issue of Feminist Review is that the contents address both ideological processes and the more action-oriented. Incidentally, Rosie Martin tells me that this was their first ever journal publication. Looking is central to photography, to ways in which photographers frame their subjects and ways in which we interpret images. The question of the gaze remains critical. We learn how to look, how to interpret what we see, and what it is permissible to observe. Given the context of the time, gender binaries were in play, with questions such as how do women look, and is there a specifically female gaze? Such questions subsequently served as a starting point for more complex reflections on seeing and cultural difference. It also heralded debates pertaining to power, documentary sensibilities, representation, and the tourist gaze. As is well known, galleries and museums became one site of questioning. But with globalisation, the power of corporations and the internet, questions of representation have become even more complex. No wonder the Guerrilla Girls are still active. The substitution of music videos for the art museum in this recent image addresses video within the music industry and also online spaces of distribution. They make some of their images freely available to download and circulate. Aside from being an effective strategy, this might also be taken as an implicit critique of the rights and permissions restrictions associated with art marketeers. Other examples of questioning and resistance took the form of women working together within frameworks that emphasised alternative stories, collective organisation, and an ethics of picture distribution. Formation of women-only collectives reinforced women's presence in the field at a time when few women photographers were associated with major documentary agencies, including independent organisations such as Magnum, which is not perfect yet, incidentally. 30 years ago, I don't think we could have imagined that two major solo exhibitions of work by women, one American and one English, would take place in London simultaneously. Lee Miller was associated with surrealism and also with work as a fashion photographer. The Imperial War Museum foregrounds Miller's extraordinary frontline achievements as one of only four American women photojournalists approved to accompany troops. But there is also extensive address to her work for Vogue and ways in which the magazine was used in liaison with government as a means of information and morale boosting for women on the home front. Miller's portrayal of women at work and leisure during the war constitutes an amazing archive of the wartime everyday. Earlier, Mrs. Albert Broom, as she was called in that era, Christina Broom, was involved in photographing the suffragettes. Of course, women in the UK over 21 have only had voting rights since 1928. It's not very long ago. A few years ago, I had a research student who worked on suffragette photography, arguing that they were the first UK political campaign to make effective use of photography, both photographs by members of suffragette groups and that of others, no doubt including work by Christina Broom. Lee Miller and Christina Broom are among many women photographers whose work is now acknowledged, but who didn't figure in the earlier histories of photography. The high-profile 150th anniversary exhibition at the Royal Academy, London, in 1989, which was also shown in Houston and in Canberra, offers an example. Of the 98 photographers included, only four were women: Arbus, Cameron, Mizalis, and Sherman. The striking cover image is by Man Ray. Maybe the marketing department selected it, assuming that glamour pictures sell books. Work by women artists, including photographers, was hidden from mainstream history, despite the significance of 20th century photographers such as Berenice Abbott, Gisele Freund, Tina Madotti, Lucia Moholy, Edith Tudor Hart, and many others. Most of you will be familiar with Val's publication, in which she discussed the contribution of a number of British women photographers in the 20th century, noting work across a range of genres, from pictorialism to studio portraiture, documentary and photojournalism, experimental artwork, or snapshots from family life. And indeed, one of the most significant developments of that era, 1980s, was acknowledgement of the status of family albums as a particular, albeit partial, mode of visual storytelling, and of women as their historical keepers. Key publications included Val's work and that of Constance Sullivan. Also, in 1994, Naomi Rosenblum's History of Women Photographers. Together, they spawned an expanding industry of research projects, often as PhD studies, that through focusing on the lives and work of particular women, have crucially expanded the archive, certainly in the British and American contexts. But there were distinctions. In Britain, post-colonial consciousness brought overseas post-empire histories and politics into play. In the USA, there was a more geographically contained focus on work by African Americans, Native Americans, and more recently, those of Hispanic or Asian background. An example would be Deborah Willis's research into the historical presence of black photographers in America, which details 19th century Main Street studios run as small businesses involving women as well as men. And looking worldwide, we would find differing socio-political currencies intersecting with questions of photography, history, and gender. Nevertheless, if we look back over the last 30 years, there has been an amazing investment in rectifying the historical record, though, as is clear from the talks lined up over the next 2 days, there is still much being investigated and questioned. So this brings me to women in photography now. What has changed and what remains to be addressed? The most obvious change is the import of the digital, partly in terms of the ubiquity of cameras, phones, and iPads, facilitating photographs and snapshots. More significantly, the speed, extent, and limited controllability of image circulation afforded by virtual space that has profoundly changed our relationship with images. The family album is no longer the selective and private story it once was. Everyday images are regularly uploaded and shared via social media. News photos are posted online 24/7. Whether or how all this will constitute a historical archive for the future remains to be determined. In addition, and partly as a result of the revolution in communications, photography as a field has developed a global consciousness. Of course, photography has operated internationally ever since its inception. Camera operators travelled and established studios worldwide and made pictures locally, but also pictures acting as mementos or sent home to tell armchair travellers of distant people and places. Now we expect instant news and information, perhaps via satellite imaging or exploring through Google Earth. The new global infrastructure incorporates us differently, rendering us as cogs within networks through which imagery is channeled. Meanwhile, the museums and public galleries, The art market, photo festivals, and the distribution of photo books have become extraordinarily international and interlinked. Paris Photo has announced that there will be over 147 galleries from 34 countries featured this year, plus 27 publishers and art book dealers. This is huge, exciting, and highly commercial. The upside of this internationalism is that critical questions, including feminist issues, have the potential to reach broader audiences. Although I'll leave those of you who are going to count women artists and reflect on the sorts of themes that feature in Paris. I missed the last Women in Photography conference here, as it clashed with Ways of Knowing in Singapore, billed as the first conference on Asian and Middle Eastern women in photographs. I was privileged enough to be invited to do a keynote there. It was very interesting. The interplay between ways of seeing and ways of knowing in the context of photography is self-evident. The double entendre of seeing, as it references both eyesight and comprehension, resonates. It is, of course, why we photograph, and how what we photograph matters. Vision is informed by, reaffirms, or challenges the ideological. The conference themes there were familiar: women, memory, and history, women in daily life, and women artists and photojournalists. Many of the speakers were based in North Africa or Asia, including Lilia Labidi from the University of Tunis, a visual anthropologist researching family photographs, and Akanksha Mehta, who is analysing women and representation in relation to the Indian Hindu nationalist movement. For example, Randa Schaaf, I don't actually quite know how to pronounce her name, so apologies if that's completely wrong. She spoke about her project Under the Same Sky, recently shown as a touchstone display at the Photographer's Gallery. She has worked as a photojournalist in Egypt for many years, and, I was told, was the first female picture editor there, working at Al Sharuk Independent Daily Paper for 6 years. In 2003, she wrote, quote, two martyrs and 49 injured people so far, at least three of them reporters. Our colleague Bishoy lies in the intensive care unit at the Coptic Hospital. We register the incidents and stifle our bitterness over the lack of vision and tell ourselves over and over that the revolution is continuing against injustice. But it is also injustice to send one of the photographers to face danger on his or her own with poor camera equipment that will not produce photos fit for circulation, without promising protection, security, or even compensation for any losses. Photojournalists have lost their cameras, lenses, and mobile phones and were not compensated. They cannot afford to buy new ones with their low salaries. Most of us never have to face the circumstances currently encountered by women in many areas of the Middle East, especially those working as photojournalists, as photographers. Yet we welcome their reportage. My focus so far has been on debates and publications, but I wanted to end with images. As a curator, now based in an academic institution that encourages interdisciplinary thinking, my work over the past 20 years has concerned land, place, and environmental change. Here, women photographers have been underrepresented historically, although there are some incredible stories of late Victorian and Edwardian women travelling with cameras or documenting their rural surroundings. I have been lucky enough to work with a number of women whose investigations have taken them to the ends of the earth, literally, in some cases. And I just was going to flag up three examples. French photographer Crystal Labar is based in London. Actually, I think she's here somewhere, and often works in conjunction with natural scientists. She astounds me by exploring forest areas at twilight, for many of us a rather unnerving liminal time of day. And here we see an installation, and I'm sorry you can't see the pictures very well, but I don't have time to go through each one of them. An installation which is based on tracking the movement of bears in a mountainous area of Croatia, northeast of Rijeka. New Zealand photographer Anne Noble, who is also a university professor and very influential, I think, as a woman professor, has visited Antarctica 3 times, travelling there under the auspices of New Zealand or US polar agencies. In terms of a geographical imagination, and even though we know of scientific projects based there, that there is a major research station at the South Pole comes as something of a shock. Without a photographer to draw attention to it, we might never think about this and its implications. And finally, Jan Preston, one of our doctoral students, has travelled the whole length of the Yangtze River, exploring alternative methods of representing its stature as a waterway and its mythological status within Chinese culture, and, of course, the import of economic change on the river and its banks. We have to admire the courage and determination of each of them and many other women in photography variously involved in questioning ways of seeing and knowing. To summarise, we have done a good job in terms of historical research, finding and exploring the work of women photographers, particularly, but not exclusively, in Europe and North America. Conversely, questions of gender and representation continue to challenge us. From an activist point of view, we urgently need alternatives to the sometimes patronising and often offensive modes of picturing women that still characterise a range of professional and commercial fields. It's about challenging established ideas and hierarchies, and we cannot do this alone. But we can work with feminist research organisations, political parties, and indeed in education, where many of us are based. We are also aware of many more women photographers internationally, and given the internet and social media, we can communicate very widely within the professional networks that constitute contemporary photographic practices. The extent to which women have become more established within photography in the last 20 or 30 years is less clear. It remains the case that there are many more highly acclaimed male photographers than women, although certain glass ceilings have been broken. For instance, this year, Helen Sear was the first woman artist ever to represent Wales at the Venice Biennale. So much has changed, but many questions remain to be addressed, which, of course, is the purpose of this conference. Thank you.